Welcome back. So today we're going to talk about process layout design and then some optimization as well. So let's take a look at how we want to design a process. So step one, we want to gather information. We need to know how much space do we think we need, how much space do we have available. Maybe we're already in a space and we want to expand into that space, or maybe we're looking at renting out a new space. Identify some closeness measures. And we can look at things like a from matrix, a relationship matrix, those types of things. We can develop alternative block plans. This is a trial and error method, and this is something that they kind of talk about in the book. Again, we can use things like similar to load distance models, minimize cost model, which is very similar, except we replace load with a cost, a value. There's a lot of software packages that are used in industry, a little bit more expensive. There's the ALDEP, which uses a relationship chart approach. There's the CRAFT method, which uses a from-to-matrix approach. Okay, step three, developing a detailed layout. Consider exact sizes and shapes of departments and work centers, including aisles and stairways. So we also want to maybe use 2D, 3D modeling. CAD software to be able to facilitate the process, because it's not just two dimensions anymore. We're actually incorporating height as well, particularly when you look at modern warehousing. It's a very different process than what it used to be when it was only a 2D layout. Okay. So let's take an example. We'll have a Recovery First clinic. So this will be our first example. First off, we want to gather some information. Facility has 50 feet by 75 feet available space. So that's some general information we have. We also know that we need six departments. So there's some predefined departments based upon specialties that we have for this clinic. The departments are radiology, laboratory, lobbies. That's not really a department, but that's where they have intake, examination rooms, surgery and recovery, and physical therapy. So these are the different areas. And the other thing that we're given, and this is actually an example you can follow in your book, notice how many square feet that we need. We need 400 square feet for radiology, roughly. And again, these are all first estimates. 300, 300, 800, and so on. Looks like physical therapy is where we need the most. So we get a total value of 3,750. Fantastic. So the first assumption, the easiest assumption, is to assume that we don't have disparities in these areas, that everything's the same size. So that's an easy assumption to make. If we do that, we can break out and make a square space of that first area. I'm gonna move that up there. So that we have 50 feet by 75 feet. And we're just throwing things down in order, A, B, C, D, E, F. So this assumes that each department's roughly 25 feet high, 25 feet in this direction, and that the 75 feet is broken down through these three parts here, so 25 feet across. So it's actually, it should look a little more squarish, but that's okay. So that's our first assumption. So when we do that, it allows us to start off with a couple things. So we can generate what we call a from-to or relationship matrix. And it tells us the relationships between each of these departments and all of the other departments. So if you notice, I have these labeled A, B, C, D, E, F, and their names on the left. On the top, A, B, C, D, E, F also represents those same departments. So they're kind of the same thing, I just don't have the names on there. Now, on the diagonal, from a from-to relationship, that means it's the same thing. So the diagonal is, so do you go from A to A? No. So any of the departments on the diagonal are the same. Now, in this case, we're doing just one to the other. So radiology to laboratory, or radiology to lobby. Now notice we have zeros for there, so this is basically stating that we don't really have much of a relationship. So with these can work out to be your number of trips. Now, you could have from to and to from, which would represent the other half of this data set below the diagonal. However, in this case, it's not so much important as to which direction we're going, but the total number of trips between two departments. So thus, if you do that, where you don't have to have both directions, which you could, but that's for different planning, then you only have to use half the matrix. So in total, between radiology A and D, the examination rooms, there's 45 trips. Now, we don't know if to or from, but it's in both directions assumed. And so on. We can see how many trips between each of the departments. And zero represents that there's no trip. It also represents that there's no real relationship between those two departments. So as you can already notice, the strong relationships are the stronger the number of trips between those things. So for small systems, particularly like this, if you're doing trial and error, the easiest thing to really look at is the larger the number of the trips, the closer those departments should be. So what you want to propose is where, for example, C, the lobby, and D, examination rooms, they have the highest score, 50. So we should prioritize that C and D are, in fact, right next to each other. Now, what that means is they're spaced one unit away. So we're going to have one unit as the 25 by 25. And so one unit away is between these two. So we want those to be together because of that 50. Then you start looking at the other largest numbers. The next two largest numbers are D to A and D to B. So we probably want those to be one unit away as well. So 45 and 45. The next thing is 43. That's the next thing. So that's F to C. So that's why we have F over here by C. And if you notice, since those are largest numbers, well, the only other place we can put E is down here. So that's probably a good estimate. Now, again, this was done by trips. There could be a way to do some things by cost, if cost was a factor, but that's not what would work in this case. So now if we look at the examples, we want to map before and after distances in arbitrary units. So this is where we're mapping, again, the X direction and the Y direction. So the existing coordinate for A was 1, 1. Remember, this is how we had them organized. So notice we have one unit and one unit. So again, this is also assuming everything's the same size. That's why we can do this very simply. And then the proposed is the new layout and the coordinates of where things positioned there. Really what we want to do then is minimize the load distance. We have a spreadsheet for that. I don't know why that keeps flipping in and out. So the load distance then is the distances between all the departments. So we have AD, AE, AF, and so on. And the number of trips. So the distance is the rectilinear distance, again, so we have to calculate the distance from the rectilinear distance. And then we take that distance, multiply it by the number of trips to get our load distance. And we do this for the existing layout, and then we can sum up all the load distances here, get a sum. And we do the same thing for the proposed layout, get the new distances, and then the load distances, sum up all the load distances, and voila, what we want is the lowest number, and the lowest number wins. So that's what we do in our Excel spreadsheet. So we have that spreadsheet in Canvas, so you want to make sure that you download that so we can work through that problem. We'll work through that problem in the worksheet in class. There's other software tools, again, ALDP, Craft. In fact, you can do some things in Excel. I'm practicing working with another networking software where I can import Excel into that and make network diagrams. So for like circular layouts, things like that. So it's really interesting. Special cases of process layouts could be things like office layouts because we may want to prioritize different things. So for example, maybe we want to promote human interaction and communication. Maybe that's one of the primary things we want to do. So we're going to position things a little bit differently to encourage that. Maybe we need to account for some physical environment or psychological needs of the organization. So that might do some different things. That oftentimes is where they outlay windows and natural lighting. So maybe proximity versus privacy and privacy. How do we have key trade-offs between those things? Open concept offices promote understanding and trust so that people can communicate and talk with each other. And then also flexible layouts, incorporating office landscaping, helping to solve some of the privacy issues and open office environments. So those are a little bit different. Those are more aesthetics rather than just efficiencies in motion. So oftentimes you'll see something very different for those. Now, there's also a special case when we talk about warehouses. So it's a different type of process layout. And in this case, our primary decision is where to locate each department relative to where the dock is. So the dock is always probably the high priority because that's where things are coming in and out of. Okay, so again, we can assume storage of equal sizes, assign the departments to locations in order to minimize the number of trips to the dock. So again, we can use load distance or we can use CG optimization, but we'd use it within a facility boundary. So different storage areas of unequal size are more interesting because now, and this is something we use for that other facility layout as well, is how do we deal with unequal sizes? So these are the steps to deal with that. So I'm going to walk you through that a little bit. So the first step is take the ratio of the number of trips relative to the storage area required. And then use the ratios to make different assignments. We'll assign the departments with the highest ratio closest to the dock, and then we'll assign the department with the second highest ratio next closest, and so on. So what does that look like? So here's an example of equal sizes versus unequal sizes. So let's say this is our facility, and we have these different storage areas. If we assume everything's equal, great. So here's our dock, and here's the aisle from the dock to any of these storage spaces. So if we determine what the number of equal area parts are needed, so for example, if Department 5 needs 3 equal 10 by 10 storage areas and Department 2 needs 1 10 by 10 area, well, we can represent that. So what we do is we make these storage areas the smallest unit that we need. So for example, each one of these would represent a 10 by 10 area. So if we needed three equal areas for, say, Department 5, we could choose any three of these depending upon our load distance model. And for this one, we'd only need one. So you break it down to the smallest divisible unit. So you can then calculate the ratio of number of trips to areas needed. So here's an example. So here we have a department where we have baseball equipment, football gear, hockey equipment, basketball equipment, and sports clothes. So these are the different departments. Trips to and from the dock. Again, this has to be data that's recorded somehow, like per day, per month, something like that. So we have 160, 100, 150, 120, 270. The number of areas needed, maybe because of the storage requirement. So maybe hockey equipment requires a lot more room than football gear, which sounds kind of funny. Baseball gear needs 2, sports clothes requires 3 areas. So to get the ratio then, we take the trips to and from the dock divided by the area needed, which is shown down here. And that's how we get the ratio of trips to area needed, the 80, 100, 150, 120, 90. So the highest number is the one that we're going to prioritize. So out of these ratios, we look across here and say, oh, 120 is the largest. That's our basketball equipment, Department 4. So Department 4 only needs one area. So that one area, there should be one of these, either this one or this one, should be right next to the dock because of that high ratio. So again, I don't know why that's doing this. So number four, we put there. Second highest ratio, 100. So that's our football gear. So they only need one area for the football gear. That's department two. So we put department two on the other side, right next to the dock. And we go down the line. The next highest number is 90 for sports clothes, but they need three 10 by 10 areas. So if you notice, we put each one of those on either side, and then we just picked one or the other. We picked up here five. And then we go down to 80, which needs two areas for baseball equipment. So that's department one. So we picked the other one across the five there and there. And then there's three departments for hockey, which was 50. So those are the remaining three. If you can see that, the remaining three here. And that's a fairly simple way to do that. Now, we can do the same thing, this method with unequal sizes, when you look back at the facility layout that we did for the clinic. You can use that same model by doing ratio of trips or figuring out what the smallest area is that's needed. All right. So with that, that's all for this discussion, and I'll see you in class where we get to play around with some of the stuff.